In the previous recorded lecture, we have seen about that the National Curriculum Framework. I hope that you must have gone through that video and there should not be any problem. However, I have also seen that only 15 of you have watched it, because it shows that the watch history. I request you please go through that, and if you have any kind of a problem, doubt, or you need any clarification, please ask for that. Okay, so that now I will be not covering, because I suppose that you have must watched that video. Okay, so just go through that once again, and if you have any sort of a problem, you can just ask me. So today in the class you will see another aspect, that is the national objective and national structure of education in India. When we see the national structure, we find that it was a Kothari commission under the leadership of D.S. Kothari and J.P. Nayak. J.P. Nayak is again the founder of, he was the active member when that the Indian Council of Social Science Research was being established. So he was the one of the active member of that. So that commission has suggested only that the structure of education what should be, that we will be seeing in this lecture later on. Before that, there was no uniformity in the structure of education. Okay, I see that some of you are making note of it, what I am saying. So I request you just now please listen and ask for any queries, because the whole video will be again available on the YouTube. And one more thing I just want to mention here, that to give the note of this topic, I have actually thought that I have sent, but today morning when I was reviewing that our Google Classroom, so I found that I have not provided, so I will be sending it also. So you just focus on listening and understanding what I am trying to mention. So before the Kothari Commission, there was no defined structure of education, that what kind of educational structure we will have. You must be knowing that now we have a 10 plus 2 plus 3 structure. Okay, till now. However, the draft national policy of education 2019 suggests something other, but since that is the in the draft form, so we will not take into account in this discussion, that we have already discussed while we were discussing the national policy on education. Okay, so before that there was no defined structure of education, and since the education comes under the concurrent list, so here state and central government both are free to make a rule. Okay, so there was a different kind of a structure throughout the country. In Orissa it was a different, in Bihar it was a different, at a central level it was something else. So there was no defined form of a structure, educational structure. It was the Kothari Commission who have suggested, and they have given a rationale also that why they are suggesting. And later on we will also see that it was not only the first made by the Kothari Commission.
Hello,
there was certain effort made by some other commissions and committees also. Okay, yes Prakash, you want to say something? Okay
sir, bahut kam sunai de raha hai sir.
Bahut kam sunai de raha hai.
Haan sir.
Okay, now it is okay.
Yes, sir. Okay, sir.
हाँ, when we see that it was not only the effort made by the Kothari Commission, but also there were certain commissions like Radhakrishnan Committee, like University Commission. So there were several commissions that we will be seeing in this lecture who have made effort to make a uniform structure of education throughout a country. So that we will see. And simultaneously, when we talk about the objectives of education, that what should be the national objective of education, it was again the Kothari Commission who have defined based upon the certain parameters and based upon that what should be done in order to achieve the objective. The point of saying is that it was not only that they have suggested some objective. So through that education we should achieve what? But they have also suggested that how we can achieve. That is the operational part that we see also in that the program of action. When we talk about the national policy of education, one thing we mention that national policy of education 86-68 was not much effective because it was not suggesting the program of action, means how that things will be achieved. Here the Kothari Commission suggests the how those objectives will be achieved. So we will start seeing, just wait some minute. So when we see the objectives of national education, means what should be the objective of national education in India, it is again the Kothari Commission, which is known as the Educational Commission 1964 to 66. The commission was formed under the leadership of D.S. Kothari, and D.S. Kothari was assisted by the J.P. Nayak. Okay, so meanwhile, since the name of J.P. Nayak is coming, I will mention one thing. There is a one book, Education Commission and After, that is written by J.P. Nayak. If you can read that book, please go through that book. It is a very wonderful book that shows the historical overview that how the education has changed in India over the time period. It is written by J.P. Nayak, who was one of the premier important member in the Education Commission report. So I request you that please go through that book if possible. Okay. So this commission suggests the four objectives that can be achieved through the education, the objectives at a national level. The first objective is the increase the productivity. Next one is promoting social and national integration. Another one is education and modernization. Another one is the developing social, moral and spiritual values. These four objective was promoted by the Education Commission, and we will see one by one these objectives. The first objective was to increase productivity, because this commission visualize that whatever the education we are having, whether it's at a school level or at a university and a college level, please remember that this is the only committee in the independent India or before the independence of India that have seen the education as a whole, very exhaustive documented piece. Okay, very exhaustive it is, and it has covered all type of education, whether it is a school education, whether it is a higher education, medical education, technology education, any kind of education. So this document talks about all kind of education. So the document suggests that whatever what kind of education we have, that must be linked to the productivity, that must increase the productivity, that must help in increasing, enhancing the productivity. Productivity in the sense of a human resource, productivity in the sense of the material resource, productivity in the sense of the economical resources, and productivity in the sense of anything, that must enhance. The education must take a lead role in enhancing the productivity. Unless or until education is helping in increasing the productivity, then that kind of education is worthless. If the education is not helping in that, then there is no meaning of that kind of education. So education must help in productivity, and in order to help the productivity, because they have suggested the education must help in increase the productivity. So how the education will help means what kind of a thing we will incorporate as a part of education so that the education will help in increasing the productivity. Then this document suggests three things, means these three things must be incorporated in the education. What were those? The first was the science. This says the science should be the integral part of a school education, because science is a thing that develops the reasoning ability, that inculcates to know the reason, to know the cause behind everything, and which develops the scientific procedures in conducting the work. So science must be the integral part of the education. We cannot deny, and that's why now we see that in some way science is a compulsory component from class 1 up to class 12. So science in some way it is a compulsory part, in some way some sort of a component of a science will be always there, so that the child must develop a scientific temper and the child must contribute in increasing, developing, enhancing the productivity of a nation. The second thing is that the suggested that work experience should be the important part. There should be the introduction of a work experience, that we know that the SUPW, social useful productive work, that must be introduced in the school curriculum, so that what will be the benefit, the child will be able to develop some sort of a skill, child will be able to develop some sort of a interest in a different kind of a work, and so that when they will go out of the school after passing 10th or 12th, they will have some sort of a skill, so directly they can go for some sort of a work, or if they are interested to go in the some specialized field, so they will have some sort of a interest, they will develop some sort of a interest. So that's why there was proposal to introduce work experience, and that's why the SUPW was introduced as a compulsory component in the school curriculum. And when we talk about the SUPW, that is the work experience, it is directly linked to the vocation. And that's why this document also suggests that there must be vocationalization of education. Means in the school education, means when the student will be passing out after spending 10 to 12 years in the school, after coming out of the school, they must have some vocational, some is sending message, repeat the name of the book. The name of the book is Education After Education in India After Independence. Actually, it missed from my. Okay, I will send the message. The name. Education in India. 1 minute. Just I will send message. Don't worry. I will send message because I was talking and it has missed, slipped from my mind. Because now I was in the different mood. Okay, I will send the message. The name. I think I may have the soft copy of the book also. So I will send the soft copy also. Otherwise, I have the hard copy also. Other question I will take when I will finish at least one or two objective. Total four objective is there. So after finishing the two objective, I will take question. So you keep posting the question. Your question will be replied after some time. So that committee suggests that there must be vocationalization of education, and after coming out of the school, they must have some sort of a skill, some sort of a interest, so that they will not feel that they have the empty mind after coming out of the school, and whatever they have studied in the school, that is meaningless when they are in the real society, in the real life. It may be questioned that it was suggested way back in 1966. And what is the situation, what is the status of vocationalization of education and including the vocational subject in the school curriculum. It may be a point of a question, but in the meaning and spirit, it was proposed that there must be introduction of vocational subjects in the school curriculum and it will be vocationalized. Second, objective was promoting social and national integration. So see, because without the national integration and the social integration, it is very difficult to for any nation to become a developed nation, unless or until we have a national and a social integration. So to achieve those things, again this document suggests three action points. That the first action point, that there must be common school system and a public education should be adopted. In spite of the private educational setup, we must adopt the public education setup. It has two reasons. The first reason is that when we will move towards the private education system, it may be costly affair, and that cannot be afforded by the majority of the people or student of the country, because at that time our economical status was not much sound. Even now also, majority of the parents cannot afford that the private education system, quality education system in a private mode. So it was visualized that it should be a responsibility of the state, that is the government, to provide public education system, quality education for all children, and it should be made available for developing the national integration, because once the children or a population of a country will be educated, then only we can think of the India can become a developed country and there will be a social and national integration. So there was a twofold meaning. One, to educate the people. Second thing, that there should be a less financial burden on the part of education. because if it is a public education setup, then it will be more, create a more financial burden over the parents. So that should be reduced. The second thing was that introduction of social and national service should be made an integral part of a school education. I think I have discussed about that, the social and national service, in the previous classes also, but once again I will mention it is in the brief, that through the developing a sense of brotherhood, sense of belongingness among the citizen of India, we can be a developed nation. And how that belongingness, how that brotherhood will be developed? By introduction of different programs that is related to the society, that is related to work with the society, like NSS, like NCC, okay, like Scout and Guide. So like that of a program should be the integral part of the education system, and when they will be participating in those programs, means the student will be participating in those programs, they will develop some sort of a social integration, social belongingness, brotherhood with the society. Okay, so that should be the important part. The next was the suitable provisions should be made for teaching mother tongue, Hindi and other modern Indian language in school. Because we understand that a child can best taught in the mother tongue only. So that's why this document talks about and suggests that education in the school must be based upon, must be based on the mother tongue. Mother tongue should be the mode of communication, medium of instruction in the school. But to have a national integration, because suppose that we are in the Bengal and we know Bengali only, in Orissa we know Oriya only, in some North Indian states we know Hindi only, okay, in the South Indian state we know Tamil, Telugu, Malayalam, Kannada kind of a language only. So it will be very difficult to communicate from each other, and that's why the kind of belongingness may not come. So that it was also made compulsory to have English as a national language till the school education, and one modern language, it may be English or international language kind of a thing, that the English. So that the three language formula was proposed by the Education Commission 1966, that is the Kothari Commission. Majority of the Indian states, they have adapted it also, but some of the states like Tamil Nadu, they have not adapted, and in those states there is a two language formula, that is the mother tongue and the English. They have not adapted Hindi. There was some socio political cause, that's why it happened. It was not only social, it was not only political, it was socio-political cause that they have not adopted Hindi as the medium of instruction or as a language, compulsory language in till the school education. And we know that education comes under the concurrent list, so they were free to make their own regulation. So that was the commission who proposed the three language formula. Okay, so I think till now we can take one question session, and then we will see other two objectives. I am just stopping the share, and if you have any question, you keep posting me. One question is there, sir, how elementary period the education can be connected with the productivity for national income? Okay, that is a question from the Subhasri Panigrahi. It is not like that the at the elementary level student will be doing something and they will contribute to the national income and productivity. No, The point of saying is that when the children will come out of the school, when the children will come out of the school, they must have some sort of a skill, some sort of interest for some different vocation. And for that, the student should be oriented. Students should be exposed by some sort of activities. The activities may include even the gardening, may include even the knitting, the knitting work, may include even the preparing the pickles or the food processing. So they will understand the basics of those trades, okay, and they can develop the some sort of interest. Suppose that by exposure to the agriculture activity or by exposure to the some farming or animal husbandry or some kind of a thing, they will develop an interest. Okay, so this is the very interesting kind of a thing, this is what I can do in the future. And when they will come up out of this school education, they can start those kind of working, because they will have an interest also, and they will have some sort of a knowledge also, and the some sort of a knowledge they can gain from other things, other source of knowledge. So here the point is in developing some skill and some interest. It is not like that when the student will be in the elementary school or even in the secondary school or even at the senior secondary level, they will earn some money and contribute to the national income. No, it is not like that. Rather than the development of interest and skill is more important. Once they will develop those things, then when they will come out of the school, they can do all those kind of activities. Suppose that some person is interested in the agriculture work, they have developed. So after 10 plus 2, they can pursue some course in that area. Suppose that someone is the doing in the animal husbandry, so they can pursue some course in that area. Or someone is interested in the food processing, so they can pursue some course in some in that area. Like that, it is like that. Okay. You keep posting question. Again, I am going towards the objective 3 and 4. So when the 4th will complete, again I will come back to the question or answer. You keep posting the questions. So the third objective was education and modernization, means through the education we should preserve our cultural heritage. It is not like that we should not preserve and we should forget. Okay, so we will whatever the question is, that we will take later on. So it is not like that when we are talking about the modern education and the education that is capable of facing the future challenge, so we should forget about the cultural heritage. Okay, it is not like that. But together with preserving the cultural heritage, we should talk about the modernization also, so that we can prepare our generations for tackling the challenges that is coming in the future. Okay, so that was the point. And this in that objective the report talks about the an education system which does not renovate itself continuously become outdated and puts hinders to progress. Means whatever the education system we have, that must continuously renovate, continuously incorporate the changes happening in and around the world. It should prepare the kind of a future challenges that may come, and through the education, we should empower the future generation to tackle all those kind of challenges. That's why this commission report suggests that there will be a modification in the curriculum at every 3 years interval of a time. It is not like that you will prepare one curriculum and it will be forever. No, whether it's a school curriculum, whether it's a curriculum at a plus two level, plus three level, undergraduate level, or even the kind of researches we are doing, that must keep changing, and the curriculum must keep changing at the time interval of 3 years. So that whatever the new things are coming out of the research throughout the world, that should be incorporated, and what are the things of less priority area, that should be removed. So that was the main focus of the report, and you can see that some of the state boards and even the some of the university keep changing their curriculum, but some of are not able to do that. Even our textbooks, even everything are keep changing. When we see the school textbook developed by the NCERT, at every interval of 2 or 3 years, they used to do the evaluation of textbook for the state, even they used to do and suggest that what should be incorporated, and they incorporate also. So that is the point of saying, and again it says to keep the pace with modernization, the IEC, that is the Indian Education Commission, is an opinion that greater emphasis must be placed on vocational subjects, science education and research. These things must be the priority area. Okay. The next one is the social, moral and spiritual value. This report also talks, and they have set one of the objective of the education, that okay, we have thought of the national integration, social integration. We have also thought of that we will prepare the child for the challenges of the future. We also talked about that the education must prepare for the vocation that the child will be pursuing in the future. But also it talks that, as I have earlier mentioned, that we should know, when we are talking about the modern education, we should never forget about that our cultural heritage, our cultural value should not get forgotten in between. And that's why it talks that the kind of education we have must develop the social, moral and spiritual values, because these are the things which binds the country in a unity. Because we have so much of the vocational opportunity, and since of a vocation I am earning so much of money, and so much of a thing is, everything is fine and good and enough, but if we don't have a moral and social values, then it will be very difficult to integrate a nation and be a developed nation. That's why this document also talks that the education that we have must work, must focus toward the social, moral and spiritual value, that must be developed out of the education that we are organizing. That's why it says to introduce education in moral, social and spiritual values in all institutions under their direct control on the lines recommended by the University Education Commission on religious and moral instruction. One more thing here it is coming, that it must be developed on the line of recommendation by the University Education Commission on religious and moral instruction. So the University Education Commission talks that through the education we must teach the children to respect the cultural diversity, respect the religious diversity available in the country. We must have the respect for each and every culture, each and every religion. We must have a respect for that. We should not think that our culture, our religion is a superior and someone is a inferior in nature. No, we should never thought. And that's this Education Commission report talks, that there must be component in the school education. There must be some sort of a text on in the school education that promotes the social, cultural, religious and moral instructions to respect the the culture and religion of each and every respect the each and every culture and religion. Okay, so that it talks about, and that's why it is directly taken from the University Education Commission. It was directly taken from there. So I think that up to here we have finished the national objectives of education. Now we will take the questions. Okay, what is the book name? Just in between the gap I have searched, that book name is Education Commission and it is Education Commission and After. Education Commission and After. I have searched the PDF of that book also, Education Commission and After. It is written by the J.P. Nayak. The PDF I will be sharing in the Google Classroom just after this class. So if you get the time, you can go through that book also. The one of the question that you have asked, that what is the unique feature of this commission. The unique feature that I was talking is that this commission is a very comprehensive commission. Why I am using the is word? Because till now we don't have that much comprehensive document in India. Even before the independent India, we have not had any comprehensive document in education. Even after independence also, this is the one and only comprehensive document in India which talks about all the labels of education, all the types of education, labels of education, whether it is elementary level, secondary level, higher secondary level, university level, higher education level, even the university level. When we talk about the different kinds of education, whether it's a school education, whether it is an engineering education, whether it's technical education, medical education, nursing education, teacher education, or any kind. So this is the only comprehensive document which talks about all kind of education. That is the very unique feature. Second unique feature is that it doesn't talk super surfacely, means on at the surface level. It talks with the evidence. What are the evidence? Why they are suggesting? Because this is the evidence. Behind the every suggestion they have evidence, and they also suggest how that we can achieve that. That is the operational part. So both the thing is incorporated in the document. So in that sense, it is a very important kind of a document. Okay, you may keep posting the other question that you have. Now we will move towards the structure of education. Okay, so when we see the structure of education, as I was talking before, that before the Education Commission, that is the Kothari Commission, we were not having a definite structure of education throughout the country. In some state, the structure was different. In some state, the structure was different. Since the education comes in the concurrent list, so every state was free to make their own educational policies, their own educational structure, and it was different from one country, sorry, one state to another state. This is the first commission who suggested that in order to have a first national integrity, second, to face the challenges of the coming times, and third, to become a developed country, fourth, that to have a uniformity in the educational system throughout the country, we must have a uniform pattern or structure of education. And that was suggested that the structure of education will be 10 plus 2 plus 3. And that should be the structure of education throughout the country, irrespective of state boards, irrespective of any state, union territory or anything. So 10 year will be the schooling, pure schooling. 2 years will be the higher secondary schooling. 3 year will be the graduation, and later on 2 year again for the postgraduate. That is not coming under this framework. Okay, so that was suggested by the Education Commission report, and this commission report, before this commission suggestion, there was a varieties of structure. In some state there was 8 years of schooling, then some sort of some kind of a schooling, and there was some pre-university kind of a course. Like that we have a intermediate course, that is a plus two level course. Instead of that, there was a pre-university type of a course of 1 year. Somewhere it was a 2 year also. It was varying from university to university because the pre-university course was conducted by the university. So there was lot of differences. Okay, so in order to have a common structure, this commission suggests that we will adopt the India will adopt 10 plus 2 plus 3 pattern of education, structure of education, irrespective of any board or any state. And this suggests, this report suggests that there will be 1 to 3 years of pre-school education. Means before starting the formal school education, the child will undergo pre-school education for 1 to 3 years, that is now organized by the Anganwadis. And Anganwadis, that is the pre-school education, is a kind of a preparatory that is a structure that prepares, that makes the child ready for the school. Because before going to the school, it is supposed that the child will have developed some sort of a communication skill, some sort of a motor skill, some sort of a writing skill. Okay, so the child will develop. So that is the part 1 to 3 years, that is the pre-school education, that will be taken care, and now it is being taken care by the Anganwadis. That was happening, and that's why in the another point, the Kothari Commission suggests that the minimum age of entry at class 1, that is the school, will be 6 years. That is the minimum age. Means before the minimum age, what the child will do? 1 to 3 years they will go to the Anganwadi and they will develop some sort of a skill that is required for attending the formal schools. So they will develop. Then again suggest that there will be a 4 years of lower primary school, that is 1 to 4 class. Then 3 years of higher primary, that is the 5, 6, 7. Then again 3 years of secondary education, that is the 8, 9, 10. And then the higher secondary is 2 years. Okay, so but you must be seeing that I am talking that secondary education is that 8, 9, 10. But we see that in the majority of the state, the secondary education is 9 and 10. And the 8th class comes under the higher primary. Okay. Because of that, because the education is under the concurrent list, so some of the state has taken the liberty to rearrange this. In some state, the secondary is 8, 9, 10. In some state, it is 9 and 10 only. But in the majority of the state, it is 9 and 10 only. But even if what is the division of lower primary, upper primary, and the secondary and the senior secondary, the main structure of education will be 10 plus 2 plus 3 only. And that the degree course will be of 3 years. Then next come to the story behind that, the 10 plus 2 plus 3. It is not like that the only education commission has suggested the education structure in India should be a 10 plus 2 plus 3. It was not like that. Before that also, even the Calcutta University Commission, that was framed in 1917 to 19, means before the independence of India, it has also suggested that there must be a matriculation, intermediate and first degree examination. It was not suggesting the structure that 10 plus 2 plus 3. However, it was suggesting that some of the basic thing that one must be having the matriculation kind of a stage, another must be an intermediate, that is a plus 2 kind of a stage, and the another may be the degree kind of a stage. It was not suggesting 10 plus 2 plus 3, but this kind of a structure it has suggested. The next one is that the Radha Krishnan University Commission, that is the 48 to 49, has repeatedly proposed that there should be 10 plus 2 plus, sorry, it has written 20, there is a 10 plus 2 plus 3 pattern of education. Here, this commission saying clearly 10 plus 2 plus 3. Previously, it was not saying clearly, it was saying only that matriculation, intermediate and graduation degree. Then at last, Secondary Education Commission, that is a 52-53, it strongly recommends that there must be a new pattern, that is the 10 plus 2 plus 3. Okay, so this suggests. One more important thing before moving towards the question and answer session is that when the 10 plus 2 plus 3 education was proposed by the Kothari Commission, it was also emphasized that there should be no examination, means you can say that exit examination, or you can say that the matriculation type of examination before completing 10 years of schooling. Means after completing 10 years of schooling, one certificate examination should be. Before that, there should be no such kind of a certificate examination. And after again 2 years, you may have another certificate examination. That's why now we have one examination after completing 10 years of schooling, then again another exam after completing plus 2 education. So that was the proposed structure of education by the Kothari Commission. Okay, So now we will have a question answer session. I think some question has come. One is from the Sonali, that is the pre school from 1 to 3 years का मतलब आंगनबाड़ी में 3 साल है या आंगनबाड़ी में 1 साल और बाकी 2 साल LKG और UKG. See, when we talk about the pre-school education, that was visualized by the Education Commission. There is a nothing word like LKG or UKG. First remember that the kindergarten system of education is a different concept. Okay, and whatever we have in the name of LKG and UKG in private schools are entirely different from the original concept of a kindergarten. I think in educational philosophy we have discussed about the kindergarten. Okay, you just go through that, the kindergarten, what is the kindergarten. It is the distorted form of the kindergarten system. That is the one thing. Second thing, as this commission was not saying anything about the kindergarten, lower kindergarten or upper kindergarten, that is the LKG or UKG. This commission was only saying that it will be a preparatory class, preparatory session, where a student will be prepared for admitting to the school. And why it was visualized? Because it is a very fact that in order to go to the school, that is, suppose that in the first class, a child must have a communication skill. The child must be able to communicate what the child needs, what kind of a child, the problem child is facing. Suppose that the child needs to go to the toilet. The child must be able to communicate to the teacher that child needs to go to the toilet. Or if the child is needs water, then the child must be able to communicate the child needs water or a food or any discomfort what the child is having. Suppose that stomach pain is there, so the discomfort the child must be able to communicate, one thing. Second thing is that the child must be able to perform some sort of the motor skill. Okay, the next thing is that child must be able to at least pick the pen or pencil and must develop some sort of a motor skill to move the hand in the desirable manner. Okay, that's why when you will go to the kindergarten school, the majority of the activities are linked to developing the motor skill, developing the physical skill to the child. So it is not like that they will go for the LKG and UKG, but it was not. But now come to the Anganwadi. At that time we were not having any structure for the preschool. Even now, except from the Anganwadi, we don't have any structure. So it was responsibility was given to the Anganwadis that you should also take care this need of the child. We cannot say that they are very formally structured for preparing school for the school education. No, they are not. But the extra responsibility has been given to take care these needs also. Okay, so they are not specialized in developing these kind of skill in the child, but they are taking care. The next point which again I would like to add, that since till now we don't have any structured curriculum for preschool education. We don't have. Repeatedly I used to mention in my lecture. But NCERT has come up with one of the curriculum. I think I have said in the class also. They have come up with one curriculum for the preschool education. Recently, I think 2019 they have come up. Okay. And Government of India is yet to adopt and organize a formal preschool education setup. Till now it is not organized by either state government or the central government. It is yet to implement. So only the curriculum we have framed, a structure we have framed, but it is yet to come. Okay, that is yet to come. Anganwadi is just taking care. They are not specialized enough, because for that they must have a sound infrastructure, trained staff. So many things are required, but they used to take care. They are not. Okay, so we can expect that in the near future, I think within 1, 2, or 3 years, the formal setup for preschool education will come up in India, because now we have formal curriculum. Now several experiments are going on, and one more thing in the last, I think it is being a little bit lengthy, but it is necessary to mention. Now whatever we have as a play school or as a kindergarten school throughout the country, in the Bhubaneswar also, in the Odisha also, so many play schools are there. They are doing activities by their own means, as they are perceiving, as they are thinking, they are doing, because we don't have a curriculum. That's why they are doing by their own. Okay, the next question is by Tanuj Sahu, that sir, what is the role of open and distance learning in national education system of education? I think this is not very much relevant to this lecture, it is relevant to the previous lecture, but I will respond since you have asked. See, the national policy of education, even the education commission also looked in the manner, they, because India is not a developed country, we don't have a very much a strong structure of education. There are lack of livelihood opportunity, there are financial problem. Suppose that I am staying in a remote village and I want to study some higher education. How I will study? Because when I will go for higher education, it will have some sort of a financial implication, and so many problems are there. So that's why they have thought, why not some education should be organized through a open and a distance mode. So those who are having the financial problem, they can also pursue. Those who are in the job and cannot devote the time, they can also pursue. Okay, those who cannot come out of the house for especially for the pursuing education, they should also take the pursue the course. So the open and distance learning system was visualized and implemented with this motive only, to provide the educational opportunity for all. We cannot say that you don't have a financial strength, so you cannot pursue the higher education. If you don't have a time, you cannot pursue the higher education. If you are working somewhere else, you cannot pursue the higher education. You can. And that's why, with that motive, the open and distance learning system was proposed and it was implemented. And before that, so many universities were organizing open and distance learning program, but one national university was established, that is the IGNU, and they have been taken the responsibility of organizing quality open and distance learning program in India. Okay, so that was the main motive.